Mordena, yes, she's standing right beside me, Louise Upston. We really appreciate her joining us at the MSD office here in Manurewa. Louise Upston, welcome. Thank you for coming out to see us here.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here.
We were just speaking to a woman who was near the front of the queue there. She is on a sole parent benefit. After she's paid the rent, the utilities, the water, the electricity and all that kind of stuff, she has $100 a week for everything else. So stuff for her kids at school, food. So she's here for a hardship allowance because she falls short. How wrong are we getting this? 576,000 hardship allowances in the September quarter.
Yeah, more than ever before. And unfortunately, there are families like her that are doing it incredibly tough right now. You know, we've seen increased pressure on the cost of living, whether it's rents going up $50 a week, petrol, of course, is more expensive. And it's absolutely heartbreaking to meet a woman like that.
You did meet her. You went and had a chat to her.
Yeah, absolutely. First time she's been here. You know, very, very tough to turn up at a work and income office and say, you can't look after yourself and your family. I've been there. It is tough. And so, actually, we're not doing well in terms of serving families in need exactly like her.
Aren't you going to make it tougher? There is a sense, and I've read and reread your social services discussion document, there is a sense that you want more stick and less carrot, that life will be tougher for that woman under a national government.
No, I completely disagree. You know, I look at that woman and I think she's doing it tough right now. She's played her part. She's been in employment. She's been looking after her kids. She's seeking work. She's doing everything she needs to play her part to support herself and her family. In times of need, that's when you expect the government support is there and available for you.
Who determines that, though? It's a subjective determination, isn't it? Who decides when her time of need is past? Who decides when she's not trying hard enough? Who decides when she should have a job and hasn't got one? Do you decide that?
So the system basically says you should be preparing and be available for work. So that's why we have obligations and consequences if you don't. And
what consequences are we talking about, though?
So consequences in terms of sanctions is the obvious one. But we're also interested in incentives. You know, what other incentives or what other support do Kiwis need to get into employment? For someone like a sole parent, it might be part-time employment. What are the barriers to them accessing it? I mean, one of the unfortunate realities about this government is business confidence is so low, actually businesses won't be taking on new staff.
I want to talk about the elephant in the room here is life and privilege and all those things. And what you and I were both talking about before is a lot of people in that queue, they have no teeth, they have drug and alcohol. Some of them don't, but there are people with various addiction issues, with mental health issues, who come from violent homes, who are just simply not as well prepared to cope with the world as you and I were.
Yeah.
How do we help those people without making it seem like helping them is an effort of will that we're not that happy about?
Yeah, so that's absolutely National Social Investment Approach. It's about using different methods, intervening early, and actually dealing with the causes and the root causes of the tragedy of some of these people's lives. You know, the level of complexity is eye-watering. I absolutely get it.
But the damage is done, isn't it, in so many cases? And so how is your discussion document dealing with the level of complexity? I guess what I want to say is, aren't you vilifying people for being poor? Aren't you vilifying people for being in need?
No, absolutely not. So you'll see that there's two elements. One is dealing with the people who are currently in the system and need support. How do we make sure we give them a hand up, not a handout, in their time of need? And that's actually them playing their part. And as you say, some people are limited in how much of that they can do. And when they're at the front line and they're asking for support, they should be getting it. But it's also about finding ways for their own self-worth and their own sense of decision-making in their life, what can they do? So that's one part of it. Then there is making sure, through social investment, we don't have the next generation of welfare dependency. So by intervening early, by looking, for example, at the 11% of our young New Zealanders who have no qualification when they leave school, I don't want them on a benefit for 20 or 30 years. That's no good for them. It's no good for their opportunity. And we want to make sure we do things differently for that group so they are not caught in the trap of a generation. So we want to break the cycle. And that's complex and it's hard. And we're going to do things differently.
You see, this is somewhat different language from your discussion document. And I've read the discussion document at length. I've read the Welfare Expert Advisory Group report at length. The Welfare Expert Advisory Group uses the word dignity 144 times. The National Social Services discussion document uses the word dignity once, and that's you referring to the dignity of work. At what stage do you believe that these people, the people who have the toughest lives, arguably, in New Zealand, also deserve dignity?
Well, I make no apologies that I say dignity comes from work. So therefore,
but how do we get them work?
Yeah.
How do we get people work who most employers aren't even going to look twice at, who won't even get a response to their application?
Well, you know, when I was Minister of Corrections, we got over 2,000 former prisoners into work. Right, so they're not at the top of the job queue for most employers. It's absolutely doable. It's intensive. You've got to provide wraparound support. You've got to deal with the individual in front of you and the problems that they need support with. It's not a one-size-fits approach, but it's totally doable. I absolutely have confidence in the people in that line and their ability to have some control over their lives. And for me, that comes from work, whether it's 5 hours a week, whether it's 40 hours a week, whether it's 2 hours a week. Actually, if you look at the social services discussion document, yep, it's firm, but it's fair. And actually, what is it about? We want every New Zealander to get ahead. We want every New Zealander to grasp hold of opportunities that are in front of them.
Even solo mums who don't get their children immunised? I mean, the identification of the solo mum, boy, oh boy, that was explicit and willful, wasn't it?
Look, we're asking New Zealanders the question. I mean, at the end of the day, immunisation rates are falling. You know, if I think about a solo mum with a sick child, a child that's got measles, isn't that making her life harder? Isn't that making it tougher for her? So, yeah, it's a suggestion. We're asking the question of New Zealanders. If New Zealanders say, no way, that's fine. If they say it's a great thing, then absolutely we look at what other ways we can get that mum greater access to immunisation.
We're less than 12 months away from election. One final question. Sorry, Shiga, one final question. And that is, can we have this discussion at a political level without a them and us tribalism, without reducing the people in the queue behind us to something less than the rest of us? Are we able to do it without vilifying people?
Well, I believe we can. You know, these are people with real lives and real needs. National is committed to making sure that we lift up every New Zealander. And it's about making sure that people have, you know, responsibilities as well as support. So absolutely it's doable.
Louise Upston, thank you so much for coming out and joining us. I look forward to talking to you often over the next 12 months as we head into the election.
Great, thank you very much.